Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this new webinar from the International Energy Agency under our Capacity Reinforcement Program for Ghana on energy statistics and energy modeling. So today we'll have a new session on energy modeling, and we are very lucky because we have three PhD students from Politecnico di Milano, very expert on several areas of energy modeling. And so today you will not hear from IEA professionals, but from Politecnico di Milano, who again, he's doing a lot of research and very interesting work as far as energy modeling is concerned. So we have Nicola and Francesco, who will be sharing with you their insights. And without further notice, I just give the floor to them to lead this session. A big thanks to the three of you, Nicola and Francesco, for your time and for sharing with our participants from Ghana all your research and the finding of your work. So thanks a lot, and I wish you all a very good session today.
Thank you very much, Arnaud, for the opportunity you gave us to be here. And my duty for this morning is to introduce the challenges and the topics related to energy in order to then have a brief overview on how those challenges are tackled in our research group. Just a few words for introducing me. I'm a PhD student here at Politecnico di Milano, and together with me there are Nicolò, my colleagues, they also are PhD students. So, as I anticipated, today we want to bring your attention to some specific issues related to energy and how energy are correlated with development, and which are the challenges that arise from this nexus. And then, after facing very briefly those issues, I will guide you in understanding how those challenges are tackled in our research group, and then Nicolò will show more in details which are the methods and model we can use to deal with those issues. Energy is crucial, and it is. It is needed to say that energy, it is at the center of global debate in the last decades. In fact, a specific goal of the Agenda 2030 is devoted exactly to it, coupling the issue of access to energy with topics related to energy efficiency and renewable energies. And also, energy is somehow at the center of the global debates which are related to climate change and climate actions. In fact, in COP21 and 22 in Paris and Marrakesh respectively, energy were on the table when dealing with issues related to climate change. But why? Because energy, it is a leverage point for our socio-economic development, because it brings the possibility to satisfy the basic needs of peoples, and so guarantee a higher quality of life. But also energy, it is related to issues related to global security, provision of materials, and the supply of all what is needed to satisfy our basic needs, as I told you. And because of those issues, it is necessary to look at these with a specific eye to the environmental issue that can be caused by energy itself. In fact, we are at a huge turning point, because there is no possibility for a sustainable development in the next future without the decreasing the over-exploitation and overuse of fossil fuel in the production of an amount of waste and pollution which is not more affordable for our environment. But on the other hand, a sudden decrease of energy consumption and a sudden cut in terms of energy provision could put under severe threat our societies and our economies. So the duty of today, the challenge of today is to face this problem from a multidimensional perspective. And the definition of sustainable development can come to our help. In fact, within sustainable development, we have to take into account three different dimensions, which are the economic one, the environmental, and also the social one. And so shall have a deeper look into each one of those dimensions. First of all, there is the environmental dimension that bring our attention to the fact that we are not in a world with infinite resources. It means that biophysical boundaries of our world are large, okay, but are not unlimited. So it is necessary to define an accountability method which can allow us to quantify which are the impacts that are associated to our consumption attitudes and to our daily life actions. And later on with Nicolò, you will see deeper in details what it means to quantify the impact associated to our actions. And then there is also the other side of the coins, which are the socioeconomic dimension. Why the use of energy is so relevant? In this graph, we might have some insights. First of all, let me define what we are seeing. In this graph is reported the total energy supply per capita. It means the average consumption per capita of energy versus the gross national income per capita, which is somehow a proxy of the average income per person. And then on the graph, we can find different countries in different positions, clusterized by different categories. In red, we have very human development countries, while in yellow, we have high human development countries and also in blue, medium human development countries. And remember that the size of bubbles represents the size of the population of each different countries. And what is interesting to notice is that especially for in the very corner of the graph, so it's is valid for medium human development country, we can find a strong correlation between those two variables, energy and national income. It means that the consumption of energy is really a leverage for economic development. It means that economic development cannot occur without the proper supply of energy. Then, after the first part of this graph, the correlation become weaker and we have a more scattered situation in which different country lies up on down or above by the line represented by the correlation, because coming to richer countries, there are many other issues which are together with the issue related to energy. And for example, it became more relevant the issue related to consumption attitudes and how can I say difference quality of the life. But shall we look now deeper also into the topic of social dimension? And so we can look at the correlation that arises between, again, the supply of energy, the total energy supply per capita, versus the Human Development Index. I shall only remember you that Human Development Index take into consideration, together with the issue of economics, also the issue of health and education. So we can see very clearly that the correlation is still valid even in this case. And the relation between energy supply and Human Development Index is very steep in the first part of this graph. It means that for low developed countries, we can assess a EV requirement of energy devoted to an increase in education attainments and health opportunities for local communities. Then, coming to the last part of the graph, you can see a asymptotic behavior of such correlation. It means that for highly developed countries, the situation comes to asymptotic condition. It means that there is no longer need to increase. There is no longer space to increase the social and economic condition of the countries by only looking at energy supply per capita. So at the end, the message is the same that the one we can take from the other graph. It means that when coming to highly developed countries, there are other issues together with energy which are relevant. But shall we come back to the issue of energy itself, which is not considered as an end by itself, but as a mean. I'm not a philosopher, I'm an engineer, but I like to contaminate my research activity with other influences that are coming from different spheres of the human knowledge. And so I faced the issue related to human dignity. Energy itself does not determine our dignity, but can be considered an instrumental right that allow us to get access to other fundamental rights, like food and health, for example. So, and this definition of energy does not come from my mind, but is something which is stated also by the UN. And this is the reason why the deeper attention has to be devoted to energy in order to achieve all the other goals that our world is facing, and which are here illustrated as the Millennium Development Goals, the previous agenda. But we know that the same structure is still valid in the 2030 agenda, where we can understand that there are several interconnections between energy and other. But shall we have a look together to which is the condition in which we are? So let's have a deeper look to some numbers. First of all, there is the issue of access to electricity. More than 1 billion people don't have access to that. And then there is the issue of clean energy. More than 2.7 billion of people still rely on traditional biomass for domestic need. It means for cooking and eating their homes. And this has very bad impacts on the social condition of a family, because as you know better than me, most of the time women are the one in charge of collecting biomass for cooking, and these exacerbate the condition within the communities. But some issues are also present in middle-income countries where it is assessed that more than 1 billion of people do not have access to reliable grid electricity. It means that in those cases, there is the connection to the national grid, but this grid is not stable enough to guarantee the development of the communities. And also, it is not enough to guarantee an utilization of electricity for productive work. And coming now to high-income countries like Italy and Europe in general, also there we are facing energy-related issues, because more than around 50 to 75 million of people are affected by fuel poverty. And with fuel poverty, I mean the issue related to the fact that people have the connection to the grid, have electrical appliances, have electric bulbs at home, but at the end of the month they cannot afford the bill for electricity and heating, and these cause the interruption of the services, and with very, very severe issue for those families. Those issues are even exacerbated by the challenges which the energy sector in as a whole is facing, because there is, first of all, the issue of oil prices that influence very much the behavior of the energy market. Then there is the issues related to renewables, the cost of solar and wind, which is decreasing over time, but which is also affected by different subsidies in different countries of the world. And associated to the deployment of renewables, are arising new issues for the electricity sector, which are related to flexibility and also to the provision of the rare materials which are needed for the production of new technologies such as PV and wind. And then, of course, last but not least, there is the issue of sustainability, because the electricity and energy sector in general is responsible for a huge amount of CO2 emission in our world. So, a deeper attention to action which devoted to the reduction of CO2 emission into the atmosphere has to be bring on the table. And the picture I've tried to describe is now hampered by a huge shock, which is the shock related to the COVID-19 pandemic condition in which we are as a world. And by looking at this graph, I don't want to detail all the numbers there, but I want to have a look together with you to this graph, where it is clearly stated that the condition from the energy perspective that we are facing nowadays is somehow similar to the condition we faced during the Second World War. And this gave us the order of magnitude of the emergency which are facing from the energy perspective. But we don't have to forget that this condition can be seen also as a huge opportunity for our world to restart again in a greener pathways for the next future. I want also only to mention that, for example, in Europe, a huge discussion is coming about the so-called Green New Deal, which is the opportunity to use the recovery funds devoted to different countries of the EU in order to push the economy with huge investments for green solution in the energy field. But let's have now a snapshot of which is the condition of African countries, which is of course the most vulnerable one, and also the one which is more affected by the crisis, the energy crisis we are facing in the world, because the bad impact of the shutdown of new investment in the energy sector has bad consequences for those communities which are nowadays lacking of the basic access to electricity and modern fuels. And also there are the other side of the coin, because in order to foresee a just energy transition, which has to be equitable for all, we cannot, we have to consider the fact that African continent is the greater producer of such raw materials which are needed for the energy transition. So a deeper look into this issue has to be done in order to have a proper just energy transition. So after having after giving you this broad perspective of which are the current challenges in the energy sector, shall have together an understanding of a general understanding of how in our research group those issues are tackled. First of all, the final aim of our research is to determine and assess integrated policies which can foresee better strategies that combine energy and economics. And towards these, a crucial role has to be devoted, is devoted to technology and innovation in general, because we cannot see innovation only as new technologies. Sometimes innovation, it also means actual technologies, but used in an innovative way, because the issue there is to find the correct way in which technology can satisfy needs of communities. And for this, a deeper understanding of which are citizen behaviors is essential, of course, in order to foresee which will be the needs. And to take into consideration all the aspects, also an attention to international cooperation is of my primary importance. So how energy modeling and modeling science in general can contribute to the challenges, you will see later on with my colleagues. But try to remember that all the models cannot represent in a one-by-one manner the world. So they can be useful only if properly understood. Okay, so in our group, we have focused the attention to a multiple layer modeling framework, exactly in order to try to assess in a mostly integrated manner the policies for future energy and economic strategies. So the first layer has to deal with the productive system, and with productive system I refer to thermodynamics, but also to the shape of demand which is needed to satisfy a certain process, and also the supply chain which is responsible to the production of a specific goods on services or service. Then there is the second layer, which is referred to bottom-up energy system models, and this is devoted to the deeper study of the energy system itself, with a deeper look on the operational issues, the dispatching, for example, and also the planning issues, which are the foresee on how the energy demand will evolve in the next future. And then, above all, there is the third layer, which integrates all the other and take into consideration the interlinkages between energy and other productive sector within an economy. To have a deeper look into the layer one, I can say that we are using both algorithms which are investigating the supply chains for different productive system, and also algorithms which are analyzing the evolution on an hourly basis of the demand, for example, for households or vehicles. And then also some instruments which are related to the system dynamics field, which are capable to foresee the evolution of different load profiles in the time. It means how a load profile can evolve year by year. Then, coming to the second layer, we are using different tools which are able to optimize a standalone and microgrids system, and I'm referring to microgrids by software, while we are using also more complex model which are useful to assess the energy system for a whole country, and I mean Calliope for the dispatching and operational part of the problems, and Osmosis for the planning issues. Then we have the third layer, the top-down mesoeconomic models, which are mostly based on input-output tables, which can be used both for comparative statics analysis, but also with linear optimization models in order to assess which are the interlinkages between the economies and consequently which are the impacts from an environmental and social perspective which can be associated to a change in the energy system. But from a broader perspective, our intention is to, as I already mentioned several times, is to define integrated policies by looking also at the different interconnection that may arise between the different goals. If we look at the perspective of the SDGs, and especially the possibility of integrating different layers of this framework that I showed you, gave us the chance to find which are some feedback that arise from different SDGs and also the impact on cascade debt that different strategies in terms of energy can have on the energy sector itself and the productive other productive sector within an economy. And I would like to close my intervention with this quotation from Albert Einstein, who say, "We cannot solve a problem by using the same kind of thinking we used when we created it." And it means exactly that. We have to change our perspective if we want to face the big challenges in the energy that we are facing today. So thank you very much for your attention. I think there is room for questions. Otherwise, we can move to the next part of Nicolò. related to question, do not hesitate either to raise your hand, so you will be allowed to speak with your mic. Otherwise, you can type in the question and answer box. Okay, I think that since there are no questions, we can move to the part related to energy modeling, the first and second layer. And so I introduce my colleague Nicolò Stevanato.
Thank you, Francesco. Thank you for leaving me the floor. I will try to give you a flavor of the kind of energy modeling that we conduct here at Politecnico. And in particular, I will talk about energy modeling at local scale. First of all, not only energy modeling at local scale, but my focus in particular in my research is energy modeling for solving or trying to address the issue of access to energy. The issue of access to energy is very well known. The problem presents very different issues compared to the kind of energy planning and energy policies that we face in Europe because of some very particular characteristics of the issue of access to energy. In particular, because the areas that are most afflicted by lack of access to energy are rural areas of developing countries, characterized by scattered population and low levels of livelihood standards. These characteristics brought together make the standard expansion and extension of the national electricity grid extremely expensive and very difficult to cover as an expense. Exactly. For this reason, other technological options are now widely adopted and considered for providing access to electricity to such populations. The role of energy modeling is to help policymakers, decision makers, and in general energy strategists to identify and select the most suitable technology for providing a solution to the problem of access to energy and identify the proper size and operational strategy to better use the identified technology. Among the most adopted nowadays technologies for solving the issue of access to energy, we have standalone systems characterized by one single technological unit per household. They serve a single user, an household, or sometimes a productive activity like could be a mill or some kind of activity like that. They make use of a single energy source, can be a single PV panel or a small DC generator, and are normally way below the 1 kilowatt of nominal power. Some examples are single DC generator, rooftop PV, mini wind turbine, could or could not include some small battery pack for using a share of electricity also during night hours in the case of PVs. This kind of solution is particularly suitable for very isolated and very low density populated areas where the cost of a mini grid would not be justified to satisfy such low energy demands. The mini grid is a kind of a middleman technology because it can satisfy multiple users and can make use of different energy sources. The most adopted technology is the hybrid PV and diesel mini grid, who mainly makes use of PV panels, but has a backup diesel generator for moments of non-generation of the PVs. Usually the size is below 500 kilowatts, and they are characterized by being suitable, especially for productive uses of electricity, because using electricity for productive scopes allows the population interested by the intervention to be able to be more prone to pay for the electricity they are receiving, because thanks to the electricity itself, they are able to foster their economical development. The third and most known, I would say, option is the grid expansion. It's very expensive and is limited by natural boundaries. If we are talking about rural and extremely isolated areas, it's not only expensive but physically difficult to bring the grid to the village. But in specific cases, it's still the best, most reliable solution that can be adopted. As I was saying, energy system modeling can be a very useful instrument for supporting, justifying, and identifying energy policy decisions. Different categories of energy system models exist. The ones that I have came across during my research are national system models, like my colleague already mentioned, Osmosis and Calliope, in which I model the behavior and the sizing of national systems, national electricity systems. Then there are models for the sizing of off-grid systems or microgrids. The most famous and commercial one is OMER, but a series of non-commercial, academic, and even open source options exist. And geospatial electrification model, of which the most famous one is ONSET, and are tools meant to identify the most suitable technology for access to electricity over a wide area. And in one shot, I'm able to have an idea of the technology that would be the least cost one to provide electricity to the entire population, to the entire off-grid population of a country. But let's go a bit more in detail in what energy modeling is. Coming from the presentation of my colleague from before, I will mainly be focusing on layer one and layer two of our three layers methodology. In terms of layer one means characterizing the technologies that are involved in my modeling. So if I am modeling an energy system like a mini grid, properly characterize and model the PV module, the battery pack, the load demand of the population is fundamental for having scientifically sound energy modeling. And then also layer two, because the modeling of the system itself and being able to derive the proper conclusions from the modeling effort is key for a good policy support system. So what is energy modeling? Probably you have already seen a lot of definitions. I will also try to give my personal definition. Is the mathematical representation of a physical phenomena, in this case of an energy system, in order to perform experiments by assessing scenarios, adaptations, and derive insights for future policies. Meaning, if I want to understand what would be the effect of implementing different policies or responding to different future scenarios of an energy system, I can make a mathematical model of the system I'm studying in order to assess on my computer rapidly a set of different scenarios and shocks that might happen to the system, and I can be ready to develop policies and strategies for the energy system I'm studying. Exist a huge variety of energy system, of energy models, mainly depending on which phenomena we want to study. We can characterize, among other things, models by temporal resolution. So we can have models that monitor the sub-second or second level, models that mainly deal with electricity and frequency fluctuations, or models that can look into decades of development of the social and economical environment in which the energy system is located. Same goes for the geographical coverage. I can have energy models that deal with one single village, one single mini-grid, up to energy models of a region, of a nation, of a continent, or exist even global energy models. But for the sake of today's lesson, we will focus on supply generation and optimal dispatch models. Models that can give me as an output the optimal sizing and the optimal dispatch strategy of an energy system in order to meet a certain energy demand. This is the standard structure of a generic energy system model of the category we are talking about today. So as an input, I have, first of all, the load demand. I have to know which demand am I trying to satisfy with the system I want to size. Availability of resources in the area. So how much solar irradiation or how much wind potential do I have in the area? Techno-economic parameters per technology, so I must be able to characterize the physical nature of every technology involved in the study. And planning parameters like discount rate and cost of every technology, market constraints. As an output, I will be able to derive the optimal capacity of every technology involved. So how many PVs, how many diesel generators do I need? Optimal dispatch, so how do I have to run these supply technologies in order to be able to operate them in the cost optimal way? I will also have outputs on the cost involved in the entire projects and an idea of the cost I will face throughout the evolution of the time observed. So in the next 20 years, if I install this mini grid and I operate it in this way, I will have to pay this amount for fuel and this amount for the maintenance of the PV panels, for example. Now, I've been talking about mini grids so far, but energy modeling, as I said, can work also at national scale. Anyway, when I'm building an energy model, being it of a mini grid or of a national system, I have to refer to the reference system model, meaning I have to outline all the resources involved in my analysis. Here I listed the most classical ones. All the conversion technologies, so how do I convert my resource into final energy or electricity in this case? This electricity will be inserted into the transmission system and then into the distribution system. I can have single regional models, or I can consider different regions characterized by different demands and different supply technologies. And I can also consider import and exports to other countries, for example. All of that, I can add the complexity to my model if I want to investigate different policies or different scenarios. But what's happening inside the box? So how do I switch from inputs to outputs? What I do is an optimization, a linear programming optimization. What does it mean, optimization? It means that I have an objective function that is usually to minimize the cost of the project, but it can vary, can be minimize the emissions throughout my entire lifetime of the project, or any other kind of objective function you can come out with. But I have to constrain my objective function to a series of physical constraints. I have to satisfy energy balances, power balances, mass balances. So I have to make my mathematical model behave according to physical rules. The energy balances, technological constraints. So my technology, for example, can only supply as much energy as its nominal power. I cannot produce more energy than that. I have market constraints, meaning that if I'm dealing with national systems, probably the most cheap technology will provide energy with a priority compared to more costly technologies. And economical constraints, meaning that I have to pay a certain amount of money for installing a technology, for maintaining a technology, for buying the fuel, for supplying the technology. Now, a bit of mathematics, just to give you an idea of what optimization means and what linear programming optimization means. So let's suppose I have this objective function that is maximize x plus y. It is just an example. In real life, can be maximize social welfare of a certain country, okay? Then I have to start adding all my constraints. So let's say I want x greater than zero and y greater than zero. I start putting a graph on my piece of paper. Then I want x to be smaller than 3, y to be smaller than 4, and x plus 2y to be greater than 2. These are my constraints, okay? Inside the region that is identified inside all of my constraints is known as the feasible region. It means every solution inside this region suits my constraints, respects my constraints. But which of them, which of all of them, which point is actually the one that satisfies my objective function? So maximizing x plus y. There is a theory, it's called the simplex algorithm, that says that if I follow the borders of my feasible region, I will eventually get to my optimal solution, no matter which direction I follow. Now, this was a two-dimensional example. Imagine what it would be in an n-dimensional case where I have several physical constraints of energy nature, of mass nature, and of economical nature. The concept is the same. My algorithm will find the solution that minimizes or maximizes my objective function, respecting a series of constraints. Now, this enough for mathematics. It is not what my objective for today, teaching you optimization. I just wanted to give you an idea of what's actually going on inside the computer. I'll give you here a brief overview of the existing models. So we have commercial models. These are the most famous ones, let's say Markel, and then evolved into TIMES, famous for being the model that the IEA EDSAP program uses in its analysis. We have MESSAGE, developed by EASA, and a version of which is used by IRENA for its analysis. We have LEAP, the one of the most ancient energy models, still today updated, very important in literature, adopted by the United Nations Framework Conference on Climate Change for some of their analysis. And for example, super famous Homer Pro, so commercial software for sizing mini grids. On the other hand, we have open source models. Open source models have different characteristics, meaning that they are free to use and they are open to the user. The user can actually see the source code, so the every single equation written inside the model can be seen by the user and can be modified if the user wants to put a slight modification to the code because the user wants to analyze something a bit different from the original scope of the modeling tool. Okay, so this was a brief overview on energy modeling for policy support. Now I will get to the main focus of my intervention today, that is off-grid energy system modeling. So modeling tools to support the sizing and optimal operation of mini-grids for rural access to electricity or to energy. The standard problem that I am facing is the sizing of a mini grid for satisfying the load of a village. To satisfy this load, I have a series of technologies that I can make use of. So it could be, for example, PV arrays, wind turbines, micro hydro if there is availability of a river next to the village, a battery bank for storing the excess energy. And I can also have some fuel-based technologies as a backup. Now, the main activity that has to be carried out is the identification of the load, because everything will depend on which demand do I have to satisfy. So I have a set of different models to identify scenarios and projections of load demand of the studied area. Once I have identified available technologies, available resources, and the demand I want to satisfy, I will get as an output from my model the sizing of the different technologies, the PV, the battery, the genset. I will have a projection of the fuel I will consume with through my fossil-based technologies. And most importantly, the projection of the investment for building the mini-grid and the O&M that I will have to pay every year to maintain and operate the mini-grid. What is most important, in my opinion, is that this entire modeling approach is still based on the needs of the community. So everything starts from the identification of the needs of the populations. I do not size a mini-grid because I want to bring electricity, period. I identify through stakeholder engagement and a lot of data collection what are the needs of the population and how they translate into electricity demand. I assess locally available resources and just then I go into a mathematical optimization of the system from which I derive an optimal size and an optimal dispatch that I then use to build business model proposals, tariff identifications, and proper layout of the project together with the local population. So, as I said, the entire approach is centered on people. Sizing of the system is driven by the demand, and the demand is built upon the needs both residential and productive needs of the populations. Through this kind of mini grids, the main objective is to foster development. So the satisfaction of needs for productive uses is central in our approach. Building on this concept, I will make an overview of a framework that we developed here at our research group to properly identify the energy system modeling effort into a greater framework. Okay, so how do I identify the load demand and the availability of resources in order to guarantee sustainability? And what do I do once I obtain my optimal capacity and my cost structure from my model? We developed what we called the comprehensive energy support planning. Because mathematical optimization alone is not enough to build an access to electricity project and not enough to guarantee sustainability and real impact on the people. That's why we developed these six steps. First, we identify the priorities. So what is actually needed in the area I'm studying? I do not want to provide kilowatts, but I want to provide the ability to carry out human activities, study activities, healthcare possibilities, commercial, so working needs, information access to information systems, and of course, light. Only through the identification of these human needs, I then translate them into kilowatts that I have to provide to the study area. On the same level, I assess the availability of resources in that specific area. It seems trivial, but a very common error is to say, okay, my mini grid will be PV based, photovoltaic based, but then I realized that I had a river next to the village that I could have exploited for micro hydro that is extremely most reliable, more reliable, more economic, and would have been very much more suitable for the specific case. So proper assessment also of available resources is key in this phase of the planning. After that, with all this information collected, I will identify the strategy that I want to carry out, because there is not one solution that works for every problem in the world. So I have to identify the proper solution among the ones I mentioned at the beginning of this intervention. Could be a solar system, could be the expansion of the grid, could be a mini grid. And only then I perform my mathematical optimization. So I receive as an output size of PV panels, how many batteries do I install? Do I install a diesel generator or not? Is it needed? Is it important to have it? And once I have all of these technological informations, I can proceed to building a proper business model to take into account all the activities that are not strictly technological, like access to credit. How do I foster development? How do I make, increase the possibility of people starting small enterprises in my area of intervention? All of these activities are fundamental in order to guarantee the sustainability throughout time of my mini-grid. Otherwise, I may incur in the risk of people not being able to pay for their electricity and the mini-grid is abandoned after only a couple of years. Then I will make a priori an expected impact evaluation of my intervention, and I will ask myself if I met the priorities that I had identified at the beginning of my process, and only then I will consider my energy strategy fully identified. Okay, so this is the kind of research and the kind of models and activities that we carry out in our group, a part of them. I will give you now, to be more grounded into real life, three case studies that we recently carried out to give you a flavor of how do we use these tools that I just laid out to you. The first case, it's a rural village in Bolivia in which through on-field campaign, we identified, as I said before, the potential needs of the population, going door by door, asking what are the main activities that the population would have liked to carry on if they had access to electricity. Only then we translated them into a load demand, okay, with an ad hoc developed model. And not only that, but since it's almost impossible to foresee the load demand of an area that never experienced access to electricity, together with the population, we developed a series of scenarios, okay? A series of possible realizations of the load demand of the area. And through a two-stage stochastic optimization, we were able to design a mini-grid that was optimal in any case of the possible realizations of the load that, that we have projected. So this is a clear example of layer one, because I am modeling the technological realization of the load demand of a village. And then with the layer two, I am proposing a solid, robust solution to face any kind of scenario that could then realize. A second case study is very similar to the first one, but we also took into account the evolution of the load, because once the population gains access to electricity, depending to a huge variety of factors, the load will realistically increase increase through time, through the years of operation of the mini grid, because not all of the load will happen at the first year. So allowing for a multi-year investment strategy, meaning I install only half of the PV panels that I need on the first year, and the second half I let the model suggest me when should I install them, we observed a very interesting decrease of investment cost, of course, and also of net present cost of the entire project, because being able to postpone my investments made the project much more affordable for the implementing company. Finally, another very interesting example, in my opinion, was the combination of two different human needs related to energy. So not only electricity, but also, for example, in this case, hot water. When I deal with microgrids, I usually only think about electricity. In this work, we explored the possibility of combining the electricity system with the thermal system of the house, so for heating domestic hot water. We considered the installation of solar collectors for heating up the water, and also electric resistances that could make use of the excess electricity produced by the PV panels for heating the water. And we observed, by combining these two different systems, a decrease in the net present cost of the project that, you, as you can see, is less than the half of the net present cost that they would have faced with the conventional microgrid. So the integration of the two systems opened the doors to very much more optimal solutions that were not feasible only considering the electric system. Thank you for your attention. This is a list of references that I used for building my presentation today. And this is my email and contacts if you wish to engage in further communications. And I'm very open to questions and discussion now, if you wish to deepen any of the subjects I presented to you today.
Increase the CO2 emissions, increase the GDP with different CO2 emissions, okay? And this is represented by the so-called representative concentration pathways that are basically depicting different possibilities that we are facing as a society from this point of view. And also the damage function can be very relevant. So if we are assuming that this CO2 is going to impact very much on us, that can change very importantly the fair price, the so-called social cost of carbon. And also the discounting is very relevant. So how important is something that I give, that I have today with respect to something that I have in 1 week or 1 year or 10 years, okay? This is very important, but these are not the only relevant aspects, because also the country can be relevant. But not only this. For example, why the country is relevant? Because if you look at these picture that is trying to give an idea of different social costs of carbon by country and different other assumption, you can see that there are some countries that can benefit from an increase of temperature because maybe they are in the very, very rigid and cold places, okay? And this, again, is something that you can have a look at in a website that is basically it's getting out of a work published on Nature that is taking into account all these aspects with also the uncertainty that I know we know that is very high in this case. Okay, so this is the social cost of carbon, but since it's very difficult, do we think that we should do something even if we are not 100% sure? Probably yes. And in fact, there are already many jurisdictions that have done some carbon pricing policy. Here I'm reporting a map from the World Bank that is showing what is going on today. And we have basically two ways of addressing carbon pricing measures that are carbon tax and emission trading system, also called ETS. What's a carbon tax? Carbon tax, I think, is very easy to imagine. So take the CO2, the balloon that you have seen in the previous slide, and apply a cost to this directly. So you are targeting actually the emission price. And in principle, this should match with the social cost of carbon, but we have seen that it's very difficult to be determined. I give you an example of Sweden because it was the first country to introduce a carbon pricing mechanism. And today, the carbon price in Sweden is about 110 euro per ton. Okay, this is an example of a carbon tax. Then in ETS, actually the mechanism is a little bit different because we are addressing the volume of emission and we are saying that there's a maximum amount of CO2 that can be emit within a certain jurisdiction. And then the market is finding by itself the right price for the ton of CO2. Of course, this ideally. So we are assuming a perfect competitive market that we know in the real world is very, it's quite far from this ideal situation. But to give you an idea of how this is built can be useful. In the Europe is the perfect example of the ETS. And currently there was a very important increase. Actually, this is probably 50 today. It's very difficult to me also to update this because it's changing day by day. But we can see that we are going to see that there are some things to be addressed also in the ETS of Europe, which was the first. And what was the last ETS? Actually, the one from China. China introduced an ETS really some months ago and after 3 years of announce. So this is just to show you how things are going today. But I was talking about CO2 prices in Europe to give you an idea of the limitation that can occur also in the most sophisticated carbon pricing mechanism. So first of all, here I reported the series of the price of CO2 for the emission trading system of Europe. And you can see that most of the time there was a very low price. A very low price that was actually not really impacting on Europeans' choices in terms of consumption and investment. And very recently we are really, this is really changing rapidly. Again, this is 50 probably today. And here I'm reporting a chart from the European Environmental Agency, and that is showing exactly what I was talking about. So the fact that during these years, actually there was no really important reduction in emission. And the emission is the black line, the verified emission, and the bars are actually the electricity produced by source in 4 different countries, Germany, UK, Poland, and Italy. If you look at the trends are not really decreasing importantly, with the exception of what happened very recently, and actually from 2013, in UK. So we see that on average, the electricity mixes are slowly moving towards renewable. But there is this exception of UK. What happened in UK? Actually, in 2013, there was a carbon floor. So a minimum price of CO2 was actually quite high around this part of the chart. That was important for the choice of investment in the in UK. And today UK is actually 50% down with respect to the emission of 1990. And this is a consequence of this line going down that you have seen here, okay? So low prices cannot be enough for a change, but increasing prices are coming in CO2 emission, okay? Another very important aspect that I would like to discuss with you, and it's going to impact a lot on what the choice of the methodology that I'm going to explain to you, is the fact that we should consider the issue of carbon emission reduction with a global perspective, not a local perspective. Why I say this? Look at this chart. Maybe very complicated, but is basically showing the CO2 emission embedded in trade. What does it mean? It means that when I'm receiving, for example, a tool here in Europe, I'm probably responsible for CO2 emission that is taking in another country. And then is this emission takes place because of a production of something that I am demanding. For example, this is the CO2 flow of China that is moving all around the world, really. And of course, around Europe, but not only. And also emission from Africa are produced in Africa, but maybe because of a request that is taking place in Europe, for example. And actually this amount of emissions, so the one embedded in trade, are actually an important part of the total and are quite relevant in, also in the economic decision that are taking place. And in order to address this, recently Ursula von der Leyen proposed the implementation of the so-called carbon border adjustments. What are carbon border adjustments? Are basically a way to give a price to the CO2 embedded on the imports. This is probably a good idea, but very difficult to be implemented, both for political reasons and also for technical reasons. We are not going to address the political issue, but we are going to focus on the technical one, because the technical point of view is actually very, very related to the industrial ecology tools that I would like to introduce to you. So what's the idea behind the industrial ecology? Is finding innovative solution to complicated environmental problems. And this is a characteristic requires to have a complex cross-sectoral analysis of these economic activities. And I'm going to introduce two different tools, two different kind of tools that are the consequential life cycle assessment approach and some other that are grounded on the attributional life cycle assessment approach. In particular, these are three different methodologies for both of these two kind of approaches that can be referred as industrial ecology tools. And in particular, all of them are taking into account the complexity and the cross-sectoral let's say cross-sectoral perspective in considering an environmental problem. But not all of them are considering, for example, time evolution, which we know that is very relevant. So only a subset of them are considering this explicitly, so to be time dependent on changes that may occur in a certain part of your analysis. And then also the fact to have different agents can be relevant. In some cases, we only have agents that behave in the same way. Some other, you can model different behaviors of different agents. And then there is also the issue of the choice of the technologies that can be driven with different assumption. The most at least for us, a suitable and acceptable assumption is the comparative advantage one, that is considering only the fact that a product will be produced and consumed where there are lower costs. And only the technological choice model are considering this without any further assumption. And then also the fact to take into account high technological infrastructure details is relevant, because we know that products are the things that are consumed, but actually for many products, we need a new infrastructure. This is the case of renewable, for example, or electric vehicles, if you think about it. And this kind of super specific level of detail, it's only present in some of these tools. Some other can consider it, but without a very high level of technology. So we are considering actually in our analysis, these two paradigms that are working together, as we are going to see. In particular, I didn't speak much on the different approaches, because there is really, I could speak for hours about different methodologies. I'm going to focus on one of them, which is the environmental input-output analysis. So just to give you a hint of what is input-output analysis, I would start from some historical hints. This professor is Vasily Leontief, and he was the father, I can say, of input-output analysis. Of course, not only the only contributor, but the main contributor. And he has a very multicultural background, moving from Berlin to England in during the 90s. It was something not so happening so often. And then he also moved to USA, but after going to Russia, working on planning economic policy agenda. In particular, in the USA, it was asked a question like this one. So what would happen if to the mineral production, to the labor demand and final consumption, if we want to increase the production of steel, because for example, we are approaching a war. This is what happened in reality. And it was, he developed the first input output table of USA because of this question. And actually, this is brought him to winning the Nobel Prize for Economics. And nowadays, GDPs are computed from input-output tables that may be more sophisticated, more evolved, but are input-output tables. But what are the assumptions, the main assumption behind input-output analysis? First of all, we should always know that there are a very relevant assumption behind every model, and in particular, in this case, we will talk about the assumption behind input-output. And the first is that economy should behave in a consistent manner, and this is implying some other more specific assumption. For example, there should be a material balance, so there should be an equality between what is produced in terms of kilos of plastics, for example, and what is consumed in terms of use in the industry, final use of the customer, or going in the landfill, for example. But this should be considered in a coherent input-output table. Same reasoning should be done also from the financial point of view. So there should be a match between what is produced in terms of value and what is consumed. This is one of the most important assumptions in input-output tables. Then another very important one is the scale invariance. So these models are assuming that that changes that could be assessed through these models are happening proportionally to the way in which they are already behaving. What does it mean? It means that if I need to produce 2 glasses, I need to produce 2 times, I need to use 2 times the inputs that are requested for producing 1. More or less, this is the driving assumption. And prices are also must be considered, because input-output tables are usually a snapshot of 1 year, and we know that actually in 1 year we can have fluctuation in prices. And this is something that should be managed when looking at input-output tables. And of course, these assumptions that are within the input-output tables are also the one of the Leontief model. And okay, what does it mean? What can I find on an input-output table practically? This is the structure of a monetary input-output table. So a table which is filled in with monetary values. Here I'm depicting a three-region input-output table, starting from Ghana, Italy, and the rest of the world, for example. And we can find information on the technology, on the domestic technologies used in these three different countries. So what do we mean with technology? We already said that, but then in the way in which inputs are transformed into output. So what is needed from a specific Ghana industry in respect to the inputs from all the other industries in Ghana. But actually, there may be also some inputs requested from Italy or the rest of the world. And this information can be found in the bilateral trade matrices in this case. And the same reasoning can be done in the terms of final demand. So now we are looking at the things that are consumed by us as consumer, not by intermediate industries. So the same reasoning can be found also here. So we have the domestic one, but also the cross-regional one. So maybe there can be a request of Ghanaian products also from Italy. And then there is the matrix of value added, which are very important. Are considering, for example, the labor, the capital, and the taxes that are also needed to develop an economic activity. And as we have said, these are not only the economic inputs, there are also some natural inputs, land, water, and CO2 emission, if we look at this with the opposite perspective. So the outflow from the economy instead of inflowing the economy, okay? And these blue lines are representing from one side what is needed in that particular sector of Ghana, for example, and where these output of the Ghanaian sector are flowing in terms of final consumption or intermediate consumption. So you have a very rapid idea of what is input output. And I can tell you that it can be used as a relevant methodological framework for addressing sustainability challenges, mainly for two reasons. We are having a very extended scope because we are looking at the economy as a whole. So we are sure that we are not missing any value, any leakage of CO2, of natural inputs, because we are considering the world picture at the same time. And then the fact that these tables are in monetary units can help us in understanding how the economy can be impacted by a certain policy, a certain input, a certain change in the technology. And what are the questions? An example of a question that we can address with input-output analysis. For example, this one, how many tons of CO2 could be allocated in different regions of the world? And in order to answer to this question, we need some inputs. So for example, defining the regions, defining the categories. So in this case, we can think about a subset of regions with respect to the world. And the impact category can be CO2, for example. And then we should know the information that we have just seen rotating in the previous slide. So the one of technology, on the how much inputs are requested for a unit of output, and so on and so forth. If we have all this information, we can have as an output the economic, social, and environmental impact on the chosen indicators, in our case only CO2. So let's try to answer to the question, how we can assume their in terms of responsibility of CO2 emission in different regions. Here I'm reporting the CO2 emission with two lines for every country. Why? Because in order to answer to this question, I may find two different answers that depend on the approach that I'm using. So from the first point of view, we can have a production-based accounting, so a territorial point of view. So I could consider the CO2 emission taking place within my country, as it happens in basically 100% of the jurisdiction that we have seen in carbon pricing in the map, the previous slide. But we can have actually a consumption-based approach also. And in particular, we can consider the CO2 emissions that are taking place all over the world to fulfill a demand that is taking place in a particular country that then can become responsible for this CO2 emission. As you can see, these two different values can be positive in the case of China, because we know that China is producing for many other countries, or negative for Europe, for example, in which we are importing more than what we are exporting. So one question, two possible answers. And this is actually related to the application that I'm going to speak in a while. So again, the role of carbon leakage. So what happens if I put a tax in Europe, for example, on CO2? The system may react by importing more from outside, and maybe in order to fulfill the same final demand, there may be needed more CO2 emission, because maybe in other part of the world, there are more carbon intensive electricity sectors, for example, okay? So again, it depends on how we allocate the CO2 emission, or in this case also other inputs from nature. And there we came back from 2016 where we developed this infographic and an article in an IEA report on this. So basically, again, OECD versus China, how different can be the responsibility for use of resources if we change the perspective. And this is relevant for CO2 emission, because we understand that the reducing pollution locally, and in this case, emission of CO2, does not mean directly a global improvement, because we should look at the supply chain as a whole. And this is something that input output can do for us. So coming finally to the application, what happened in this publication that I'm talking about? Basically, we model two different paradigms, the one that we have seen, so production-based accounting and consumption-based accounting. And we try to ask to ourselves, what would happen if in Europe we would change the approach of carbon emission reduction from production-based to consumption-based? Actually, we don't have a second planet to do this and have a parallel world and look at what happened. So we need to model the world. And we are using, of course, a modeling approach. And actually, we are combining the multi-regional input-output system with linear optimization in the so-called World Trade Model framework. What are the characteristics of this framework? It's a comparative statics, which means that we are asking the question, considering that the change is taking place tomorrow morning. And so we are occurring this overnight. So you would understand that there are no technological solution of, no technological changes allowed. The only thing that it can change are the production and import patterns, in the sense that increasing the level of reduction of CO2 may imply an increase in the production of some commodities that are then imported to Europe in other places in the world. and that why this is taking, how we do, we model this by modeling comparative advantage. This is exactly the, what I've just said, okay? So we start from a database and we are proposing some equations to the model that then is finding a new solution that is should be in line with the real world and somehow was in line with the production and import patterns that we are looking at in the real world. And then we move perturbating this baseline case, introducing more and more stringent reduction of CO2, first with the PBA approach and then with the CBA approach. And these are the main equations that are driving the model. So minimize the global cost of production in the whole world while guaranteeing a satisfaction of final demand. And considering that you cannot in every part of the world exceed the exploitation of natural resources, for example, but also of maximum amount of CO2, okay? And then of course the production should be positive. These are the results that are coming out of our model. And we reported these results with the following. So on the y-axis, you can see the CO2 emission variation in terms of percentage change with respect to the baseline, the global emission, okay? And with the bars, we are distinguishing the contribution to the CO2 emission from Europe, in which we have the policy, and in the rest of the world in which we have no policy. And the x-axis is basically showing the reduction of the carbon budget of Europe. What does it mean? That moving from 1 to 40, we are moving towards more and more stringent carbon pricing policy because we are reducing the maximum amount of CO2 that can be released in the representation of the world, okay? And what happened? The black line is basically showing the net change. So the change of CO2 emission in global terms. And we see that moving from low to high level of reduction of CO2 in Europe, because the carbon budget is the European one, we are experiencing an increase in terms of CO2 emission, while in Europe, CO2 emissions are decreasing. So basically, here is carbon leakage is taking place. If we are approaching the reduction of CO2 in Europe with a carbon, a consumption-based accounting, carbon emissions are decreasing also in a global way, with a global perspective. So carbon leakage is not occurring. And so this is the finding of our study. And here you can find some details in terms of region and sector, considering that, of course, both of these policies are increasing the overall cost of economic factor because we are introducing another constraint. And so the request is increasing, okay? And again, but the important message is that considering global, the CO2 emission reduction challenge with a global perspective can lead to more efficient carbon reduction mechanism. With this, I thank you for your attention and I leave you the floor for questions or for closing the day. The moment I see no questions, we may wait some seconds to see if you are writing them. Otherwise, I will leave the floor to Arnaud.
Thank you, Nicolo. While participants may write some questions, I'd just like to to remind to all participants that tomorrow we'll have an extra session on energy modeling that will be given by other partners from Imperial College, also doing a lot of work on energy modeling in a number of specific areas, energy access, but also developing a lot of online open source tools that you might be interested in using. So this will be tomorrow. We'll see at same time, so 9 a.m. Accra time.
Okay, there is a question. Okay, a participant that has raised the hand. I can. Okay,
thank you for the presentation. So looking at how we can achieve global cooperation or collaboration in reducing CO2 emissions. And I want to find out from you, first and foremost, if you have a chart on the contribution to CO2 emissions per economic region. So how much is ECOWAS contributing to global CO2 emission on an annual basis? How much Europe is doing and the other SADC in the Southern Africa and other economic zones are producing or adding up to the CO2 emission? And the reason why that chart to be of importance to the discussion is to show where we really have to hone in our effort globally so that CO2 emissions can be reduced, or whether certain region probably can be given an exemption for some, let's say, a period of 5 years before they are even roping into global effort to reduce CO2 emissions. I don't know if my question is clear enough.
Yeah, I think so. I try to answer, but please, you can interrupt me if you want to add something else. I think what you are pointing out is super relevant. And actually, we didn't have time to go through also to this, because carbon pricing mechanisms are just a way to, well, from one side, incentivize and subsidize some activities and some investment that can be better from the point of view of CO2. From the other side, there are also a revenue source, okay? And how we are going to spend these revenues is actually very crucial. We can say from a modeling perspective, thinking about an ideal world in which cooperating is super easy, I would say that the most efficient way to reduce CO2 emission globally is starting from where it's the cost of abatement of CO2 is lower. And usually in countries, for example, like the African ones, less amount of money is sufficient to reduce, more importantly, the CO2 emission. So in general, I would say that it could be efficient, not only, I would say, from my personal point of view, fair, to help in the part of the world in which it's possible to reduce CO2 emission at a lower cost. And so I would see the cooperation opportunities also taking the revenues, for example, of mechanism in Europe, for example, for addressing this issue. This is partially happening, I would say, in some form, but probably we should do more from this point of view. I don't know if I answered to your question.
I think it did. But just a follow-up to that. So in sometime 2017, sorry if these questions are a bit off your core presentation, because I think when we are discussing CO2, methodology matters, but policy from the governmental level is one of the key drivers. For instance, I noticed in your presentation that political and financial will is one of the key factors in achieving this. So in 2017, we noticed that the global collaboration and cooperation to achieve this reduction in CO2 emission was a bit broken. We recognize under President Trump, US withdrew their collaboration or cooperation with the Paris Accord and all that. Given that there are new leadership, you now have a new leader in US, how has that changed the effort to reduce CO2 in the developed world?
I think this is also relevant, and I'm also pointing out in some of the works that I have made the fact that unfortunately political priorities may change even rapidly. And this is what happened, for example, in USA, as you said. And so thinking about something more robust, which cannot be, I don't know, changed by different jurisdiction in different times, may be better. But actually, again, we are moving in the policy world, let's say, in which the model is not enough. An optimization model, unfortunately, cannot work in that framework. But thank you very much for your comments. I now would like to answer also to Anne-Marie. In the CO2 emission data collection, is the data collected before industrialized countries apply their certified emission reductions, credits, or after? I tried to read again. I'm not sure I got it. The CO2 emission data is actually estimated in different ways. There are different approaches. For example, the one that I've showed to you, the carbon monitor one, is starting from daily based data on the consumption of fuels, in which we know that there is a stoichiometry, and so the amount of CO2 per unit of fuel is always the same. So there are some data that are easier to be could be collected, some other that may be related to other greenhouse gases that are way more difficult to be collected. But again, probably I didn't get your answer well, your question well. So I'm sorry for that. Or if you want to open the mic or to write again, I can try to answer.
Maybe to jump in, Nicolo, if I may, I think Anne-Marie is referring to the certified emission reductions, which are those carbon credits under the Kyoto Protocol. And as you rightly pointed out, when IEA or other entities publish data on CO2 emissions for a country, it's related on data coming from the energy sector, consumption, demand, and based on the emission factor, we are able to come up with a number of quantity of CO2 equivalent, which is emitted by each country. Those carbon credits are something I think very, very different and not entering into the CO2 accounting for each country. And just to point out, and also referring to Sylvester's question, the IEA is tracking energy data from all countries or regions, and including CO2. And we will have in a couple of weeks a webinar on our latest report, which is a global energy review, tracking all those consumptions data, including CO2 emissions, where we have done estimations for the entire year 2021. We also have the latest data from 2020. And just to share a few findings, as you, of course, mentioned, Africa is responsible for a very low share of global CO2 emissions. And what is very concerning is that in 2021, we see emissions going up again after this very special year of 2020 when it it went down due to the pandemic and all the lockdown and other measures. So there is really some strong actions many governments can take, and we will be able to share more findings and to discuss more the regional specificities behind this this picture.
Yeah, thank you very much, Arnaud, for complimenting. I think we answer to Anne, and I see no other questions for today.
Okay, then I would like to thank you very, very much, Niccolo, Francesco, Niccolo, for your great presentation today. I think it was very, very helpful and insightful to get you, to see you presenting your work, to see that it can resonate with what we have discussed under our IEA approach. And you also put light on complementary or deeper works. So I hope it was of your interest to all participants. And I would also like to thank all of you for your attention and for your time today. So we'll meet again tomorrow, same time. And I wish to all of you a very good day.
Thank you very much. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Nice day, bye.
Bye, see you.